want to begin by thanking Denise. I don't know if she can hear me, but we, and Aaron, who helped us to get connected, we kind of thought, you know, we're going to be talking about reading and resources for parents, and what better place to do it than at the public library. I think it's just a really nice connection for all of you. You get to take books out afterwards, and I think it's a really important that the schools and the town are connected in educating students and providing resources together. So that's why we had the idea of having it here. And I guess just as we start, I wanted to have just a show of hands, center school parents. And any other non-center school parents? Elmwood?
No.
Nope?
Or future center school parents?
Future center.
Oh, future, thank you. Future. I actually know you. She came to the budget forum. And I want to thank HCAM for being here as well, and for helping us out by recording this for you. I'll give you the format. So it's four sessions. It's intended to be a series that builds on the week before. It doesn't mean that it gets increasingly difficult. It's just different. Different strategies each week. We want you to go home, practice the strategies with your reader, and come back and talk about it. And we'll start by even just sharing experiences of how that was for you with your reader at home. Then we'll give you four more strategies, send you on your way to practice those, and so on. If you can't make them all, no problem, because HCAM is going to be recording, so you'll be able to check in that way. And the strategies will be copied and handed out like this as a handout on a different colored star each week. And we'll bring them here and leave them at the library. So if you have to miss one, no problem. There's all sorts of ways that you can tune in. But do know it's not just a repeat of the same thing four times. It's going to be different strategies, different weeks. We don't want to overwhelm you, and we also want to give you the chance to try them out. In the end, the goal is that you'll have 16 to 20 different strategies that you can use with your child, that you can provide your child choice about what strategies. They'll get favorites. You can, you know, stick them on the bedroom wall or on the fridge, and they can, because there's a picture, they can choose the strategy that they enjoy. Or you might know, because you're going to be so well trained, that this is the perfect strategy to use with this book. And so then you'll be able to have a lot of different strategies in your back pocket. So just before I begin the overview, though, does any brave soul want to tell me a strategy that they know if their child gets stuck on a word, what you would say to them? What might you say if your child was struggling with something? What's something that was said to you when you were learning to read? Yes?
Shorten the word, like look for little pockets.
That's actually quite advanced.
That's not in week
very advanced. I thought somebody was going to say sound it out, but that you're clearly in advance. You might need the graduate course of this. But really, that is a go-to one that we use, and we're going to talk about it some more, and it can be great, but it can just not work as well. And so using strategies strategically is what this is going to all be about. So we're going to give you a little background. You also have the handout. The handout will grow. So I didn't want to give you the whole thing all at once. By the time this ends, you will have a resource of strategies as well as websites that you can go to for even more information. So each week we'll add to your handout, but in the end, the whole thing will be available on our website. So do you want to do
this part? Sure. Something that, especially for younger readers, that's so important is to develop that love of learning and that enjoyment of reading time. And quite often, parents at this level, you know, unwittingly are having their child read to them. It's exhausting for them. There's a lot of work that goes into reading. So many different functions are occurring in the brain that we just don't see. And it's wonderful. We're going to talk about how to support children to decode, but we also want them to instill a love of learning and a love of reading. So when we talk about reading, we want you to find a nice little nook, a place to read in your house. It could be in the living room, in a bedroom, at the kitchen table, wherever it may be, but distraction free, meaning not in front of the TV or an electronic that you're constantly going back to, which is parents, that's hard, not checking your phone for your text messages as well, because you want to send the message that this time is important, it's valuable, and you're developing that quality time with each other. So we not only want to talk about strategies to help your developing reader, but also talk about you reading to your child, because you're going to be expanding vocabulary, material that they would not yet be able to read, but you're going to broaden their horizons and just share a little bit of the world with via your reading. And as you read to your child, you're modeling fluency, you're modeling inflection, your voice has prosody, it's changing based on the text, or you know, the large print, all capital letters, or a question. So those are keys that your student, your child, will hear without you directly teaching it. They will absorb that. So that's an important aspect for us.
I just want to add to that,
yes,
that so often, you know, we think the minute our child is learning to read, that we need to, that's the job now. Now we need to listen to them read every night. And I think just to remember Lauren's comments are so important. It really is the single most important thing you can do to promote reading success is continue to read to them. And Lauren and I, when we were preparing tonight, you used an example.
Yes, I was invited as a community reader at Hopkins School. So I practiced reading at home with my fourth grader and my sixth grader. My fourth grader wanted to know if that book was ours, and sadly I had to say it was not. You know, but I could get it. It was thrilling that he was interested. And even my sixth grader was lingering around. And it was a wonderful story, but they enjoyed, and their boys, mind you, they enjoyed listening to me read. You know, as cool as that may or may not be for that middle school, upper elementary, they still enjoyed. They had great questions, nice vocabulary words, that even when your children are readers, don't stop reading to them.
It will really help them. Well, I think this is maybe the next one. So we've already talked about the strategies, so you already know that. But the modeling that Lauren's talking about, the enthusiasm that you show for reading, and just the love of it, you know, they really, you want to find a balance between continuing to read aloud, as they will not be able to access nearly the vocabulary that they will hear as you read to them. And yet, as they get increasing their skills, the fact that they've heard those vocabulary words will really help them when they get to a tricky word. And we're going to talk about using context as a strategy.
Because vocabulary, almost think of when your child was first trying different foods and how many attempts it was until they liked it or they truly tried it. That's true with vocabulary words. You need multiple exposures, hearing it in context, to truly own that word. So reading to children is just a great avenue to build vocabulary in a meaningful manner. And when you are reading to your child, plan it at a time when you're ready to enjoy it, not right when you come home and you know you've got supper and you have to unpack backpacks and what's lunch going to be tomorrow, because without even saying it, it's conveyed. Children pick up on everything. They know how to read parents when they're busy and stressed. So make sure that it's a time that you can really relax and enjoy it with your child, and then they will look forward to that as well.
So the nice thing about these strategies is that they're very supportive, because I'm listening to Lauren and thinking the tricky place for you is, where do you find that just perfect time? You've got activities, we understand, they're getting ready for tomorrow, and you want them to be relaxed at bedtime. So you don't want it to be stressful, and yet you do want to have that chance for both you to read to your child and your child to read to you. So that's what's really nice. We will stress that you are not your child's teacher. Right, and you need to leave that to the schools, and one of our reading specialists is here tonight. Wave to us, Nina. They do a really wonderful job of that, and that's not your job. Your job is to really, just encourage your child and make them feel like wherever they are in the reading process is absolutely perfect. They're exactly where they're supposed to be, and the schools are going to help take them to the next step. But as a parent, you really want them to not feel that this reading thing is a scary thing, or that it's stressful, or a battle. I touched on this when I said how important it was for you to be reading, but the idea is that they're listening comprehension just because of oral language development, right? They've been listening to talk around them since before they were born, and so they really have a higher level of listening comprehension than they do for reading comprehension, and that won't catch up for many, many years.
And so that's why it's so important for you to read aloud to them.
So when you are reading books to your child that are beyond what they could read, but they're interested in the topic, or now there are so many movies that are also books, just take into account what's occurring in the story for the emotional level. Even though children might be interested in a concept or topic, there might be some other elements of that story that just socially and emotionally, they're just not ready to handle and to sort out. Doesn't mean they can't be interested in the topic. That might be a great trip to the library to find other books on the same genre, the same story theme that might be at an appropriate level for them. And we talked about reading to your child even when they are a reader. Just that modeling, your job as a parent is never over. So even when they're at Hopkins School, in middle school, you're just constantly building that modeling and that love of reading.
So I just want to stop for 1 minute to say that thank you all for making time to be here. I had said to Aaron, you know, that if we could get, you know, 20 people, I would be thrilled, and we have already exceeded that. It just goes to show what wonderful parents we have in Hopkinton, and we're partners in this process, but we can't be partners unless, you know, you take the time to come out to something like this. So just thank you so much for making the time. We want to talk a little bit now this is segueing into a conversation about a book that's going to be too hard for them to read themselves. So this is a read aloud, but what you can also include in the read aloud is a little bit of getting them to think a little bit more deeply than just passively listening. So in your handout, it talks about before, during, and after the read aloud. And we're going to demonstrate that a little bit for you tonight with this book. Understanding. Right, so those of you who may not be able to see it at the back, the name of the book is Hurricane, and I'm going to just show you the illustration. Your child will most likely not be able to read the title, right? So we want to have them look at the picture. It's a really rich illustration. There's lots going on in that photo. So before we would even open the book, we would tell the child the name of the book, this story, about a hurricane. They might need to talk about what a hurricane is. And then, what would we ask them with the picture here, Lauren? Do you want to stand up here?
You might say, where do you think these children are? What do you think is happening right now? What do you notice with the illustrations, with the picture? If you look closely, you'll see the rain. It's at an angle, so that would show some force with the rain. The leaves are blowing, and they're looking up. What might they be looking up at?
Mm-hmm. And they're looking nervous, right? So now you talk about a little bit, provide a little bit of context, and maybe help them to make a connection. Was there ever a time when you were feeling a little bit worried about the weather? Now they can connect to the story, and there's some background information that they bring as you read it to them. We know that it's all about them, right? So if it's something that they can relate to, they're going to bring already some background knowledge to the listening, and it's going to be richer.
So they might then now launch into a story about the storm last summer when they were here, there, and everywhere. So you can refocus them back to the book. Yes, I remember that. Let's see. I wonder what will happen to these children in the story. Because otherwise, if you let them go off too much, it's a little tough to return back.
And then we might read a couple of pages together, right? So they've got this background knowledge. They've made some predictions about what might be happening in the story. And then just, again, stop at a strategic moment. As you read, either their prediction was correct, and that's a good time to talk about, it's just an idea. There's no right or wrong here, but you predicted that this would happen. The story's kind of taking a different turn. And just pause for long enough to re-engage them. You also don't have to finish it. I mean, you might do part of a read aloud, and let's wait and see what's going to happen tomorrow night. Right? Then when you come back tomorrow night, wherever you left off, you're going to spend a couple of minutes before the reading talking about what happened yesterday.
Which is a great recall skill for children to think back and recall what they heard, the sequence of events. They might tell you the story, what they heard last, and you might remind them, okay, what happened at the beginning of the story. That's a great skill.
If you come to a
difficult vocabulary word. That's another place. Not that you want to take away from the enjoyment of the story, but just if you read a word that you really don't think that they're going to be able to understand. Well, the radio said we could expect sustained winds of 50 miles per hour gusting to 90 any time now, and the hurricane is still 50 miles off the coast. They might, even when I read that sentence, it really doesn't let me know what sustained means. So you might want to go back at the end of that page and talk about what that, now you're teaching them, they have a little bit more vocabulary. So don't think that you can only stop in a chapter book. You absolutely can make a prediction and then say, well, let's see what happens when we read some more about this tomorrow night. What do we have for after?
For during, we talked, the pictures would also reinforce some of those vocabulary words. I think we talked about that. For after, well, we talk about the characters and events. So when you look at this.
When you're finished the whole story.
Yes, when you're finished
right.
The whole story. And what occurred over the course of the story, you can see from the illustrations, the duration of the storms, how they were feeling. It also adds some perspective. It's difficult for children, especially at the younger age, to take the view of another. Mm-hmm. Storybooks are a wonderful avenue where you've got a story, you have illustrations to help them think of how they might have felt, or and then relate that to the characters.
And that's really helping us out, because one of the things that's really difficult that we want children to do early on, and we want them to do it with standardized testing as well, is a story retell. So retell a story just from nowhere, it doesn't give them any context. But if you practice with them talking about characters, events, problem solution, now already you're giving them the format to do a retell. And if they've got the format, then it's very easy for them to do it. You know, you can talk about some major events in the story, and when was the biggest problem, and what did they do to solve that problem. Now all of a sudden, and you can do this in the car, right? You could just have been read a book together, and you could be traveling in the car and practice doing a retell, because it's a very good skill for kids to have. Really helps them with their comprehension.
And at the end of the story, now you can bring back that story when they were talking about the storm last summer, and you can do a little compare and contrast. Yes, I do remember that story. We did have winds. They were sustained as well. What was different is this might have occurred at night. Our storm was during the day. So then they're making a personal connection to the test. You can also make some connections to other books that you may have read, or even a movie that you saw together. And then if it's another story, that's called text-to-text connections, which is taking two pieces of information and comparing them to each other. For children to be able to do that with support is just a wonderful ability to think and shift gears back and forth. How are things alike? How are they different? And with some support, younger children are able to do that.
And then the final connection that is in your handout is just the whole feelings piece. And again, you know, if they can relate their feelings, as Lauren already said, to something that has happened in their life, it really helps them to remember the story because they have something to connect it to. Okay, let us pause for a second. Questions? So far, we're good? Okay. So we're going to move into the portion of the evening that really talks about specific strategies. We're going to demonstrate them. I wanted to, though, credit the Halton Board of Education, where I was a first grade teacher in Ontario, Canada. That's where this program comes from. It's called All-Star Reading, and it was developed by a couple of reading specialists intended specifically for parents and coaches. So we would train parents just like this, but we would also train parents to then come into the school and be a coach supporting these kinds of strategies. And the strategies is really the idea is to encourage children to become more self-directed and to take responsibility for constructing reading strategies that work for them. The idea is that when you're not there beside them, or when their coach is not beside them, or their teacher is not beside them, that they know some ways and some strategies that they can apply to unknown words that they can do independently. So struggling readers do one of two things, unless we teach them otherwise. Anybody want to make a guess? If your child, maybe they are not struggling, but they get stuck on a word, they're not sure what it is, what might they do?
Guess.
Right. And if skip it or?
Guess.
Right. Well, skip it, guess, or ask for help. Okay, so guessing is actually a good strategy. We're going to teach it to you. But
So what happens with a struggling reader is that they don't have their guide beside them and they skip it. What happens? So they don't learn any decoding strategies, they don't learn any word-solving strategies, they just simply leave it out, and their reading doesn't improve. The best place to improve your reading is on the tricky word. So unless they reach, that's why just write books are so important. Not too many mistakes that discourage the child, but enough mistakes that they can apply strategy. And then they start to improve their reading. So it's important that they get stuck, and it's important that you don't help them, but that you support them to solve the word themselves. And that's what this is all about. So the first strategy, and we have a handout for you to take back with you, and it has not only the strategy, but it has a summary on the back for the parent, so that you can recall all the things that we tell you tonight. So we're going to compare look at the book with look at the pictures. They're two very different strategies. The first one we used a little bit already with Hurricane, but we're going to use it now with a book that the child will be reading themselves.
Okay, so I am the child.
So Lauren's the child. We'll flip next week. The first and very important thing that I'm going to do with Lauren is I'm going to make sure that she is holding the book. Really, really important. The reader is owning the book. And we're going to be the guide on the side supporting them, but it makes them feel really good when they get to be the person that's holding the book. And so, but I am going to start off by prompting Lauren, what do you notice about this story?
I see some children, they're on tracks, and their backs are, I don't see their faces.
We can just show you. So children on a train track, in the middle of the train track.
Right. Okay. That's not good to do.
No.
You know, I'm not saying something like that. That's not safe. Okay.
So we continue to prompt. Now, we're not going to do the whole book because we know we don't have time for that, mm-hmm. but we're going to do some key pages that we'll just kind of flip to, and there's two things that I want to do. She's going to be reading, so I want to be able to plant tricky words, words that I know she's going to have trouble with, and I would plant them by talking about the picture with her. Then the chances are better that when she gets back to that page, she's going to get that tricky word, okay? So you're going to listen to me do it. So they're still in the train tracks, and it looks like they are going to be wondering if it's going to be a passenger train or a freight train.
What's a passenger train?
See, so we would get some conversations around the vocabulary, but I just planted passenger and freight, knowing that those were two words that she was going to have trouble with. And now when she comes back to read it, we knew when the passenger trains passed. Can you read the next sentence?
But the freight trains didn't run on schedule.
And she wouldn't have got scheduled either. But, right, so, but that's the idea, that when you have some tricky words like that, that you can pre-plant them and they can feel super successful when they get back to that page. Okay, this was another important one. So we also, on this page, there you can see ever-increasing font, and this is really important strategy. You know, this shouldn't be giving this book to the parents, but the train is getting ever closer as they are walking on the tracks. And finally, you see this symbol, and we can talk about this. Oh my goodness, I just took the book away from her. Oh my goodness, Lauren, what do you think is going on? What do you think that might be?
I think those are lights, like the train is coming.
You notice that the letters are getting bigger?
Yes.
What do you think?
And it's only once now, one time.
Yeah.
Where it was woohoo on the other page, now it's only once.
So what do you think?
And they're running. I think the train's right there.
Right. So to give us some context, the other thing that's important there is that the font gets larger, capital letters, it's getting closer, and what we're teaching kids is that that matters. We just know that, but they don't know that. It's a really good strategy to be noticing font and print and the fact that the excitement is building because the letters are getting bigger. So those are all things when we were previewing, looking at the book, these are features of this text that would be important to point out.
And we're looking at their visual facial expressions. You can see the change from having fun, playing, now there's sort of that you can tell that child's yelling, almost with an imperative look on his face. They're starting to move, push a little bit out of the way, which supports the larger font, the light's getting larger. So that helps contribute to the story, is looking at the picture and trying to help identify what's occurring.
Okay, so the idea of looking at the book is a preview strategy, something that we do during the read, whereas look at the pictures is. And that's why we wanted to introduce both of them tonight. Previewing can be a really very low stress thing to do, and you might find your child really wants to keep choosing that one, and that's okay, because they're learning a lot from it, and they will move on. But if they want to, you know, I really like that one there that says, mm-hmm. look at the book, let's do that one again, mm-hmm. That's okay, because it really is previewing and planting some vocabulary and some prior knowledge about the story.
So you might preview certain aspects of the book, certain pages that you find that they would find very interesting, a lot of text features, vocabulary. You might do a picture walk, that's sometimes children refer to that at school, to look through the book to help with that prediction that they had on the cover, for example, of the hurricane book. You might look through, but you might purposely stop it so that then you can determine if your prediction was what the author was thinking as well, or thought of something different. You might have certain pages that you stop and say, gosh, I wonder what's happening on that page. Because to have a tree like that and you look at the size of the children and the size of the tree just enriches your conversation that then in turn when you read that page would just bring greater meaning to that page.
Okay, any questions about Look at the Book?
This is going to be good. I'm actually embarrassed to ask this question.
That's the best kind to ask. Good for you, Lori.
So this goes on the assumption that you've read the book ahead of time before the kid, right? Yes, because that doesn't always happen in my house.
No,
so.
But it could be a book that you've read with another child, okay. And so you're familiar with the book. Absolutely, we are not expecting you to preview and right. tab the pages.
Right.
No. But we're thinking, use this strategy either as a preview before a read aloud that you're going to do, just as an opportunity, or it's a book that you just know because it's a family favorite and you happen to know that there's some tricky words in there that we could preview.
And you would model wondering and predictions. Oh, wow, I wonder what this book is about. I see this. And you would have genuine wondering. So that's not a bad thing to model for children. And if your prediction was not exactly what happened, modeling how you handle that. Because children have such a difficult time when they're making predictions thinking it has to be just right. And that's not the case. So, oh wow, look at that's what the author decided to do. It's wonderful to be able to model that.
One thing I like to talk about, and it's probably something that's going to come up in one of the other weeks, but I always like to remind parents what it was like when your child was learning to speak. So, were you anxious about that? No. We're not typically anxious. We might kind of compare with the neighbor's child, but we're not anxious about it. We know it's going to happen, and we provide wonderful, natural modeling without anybody teaching us, right? So we correct the child by, you know, me want cookie, and we give them the cookie, and we expand on it. Oh, you want a chocolate chip cookie or a ginger snap cookie? Right now we're expanding vocabulary. We're giving them choice. We just do that naturally. But when it comes to reading, we get very nervous and anxious, and that comes across to our kids. It really does. So the idea is to just back off, enjoy, make them feel good about the reading, and you will be very amazed at what effect that has. So look at the pictures is one of my very favorite strategies to teach parents from the very beginning, because it's the one where I've heard parents say, that's cheating. Right? Covering up the picture and saying, that's cheating, right? And so it's actually a strategy that we teach directly. It's a very important early reading strategy. Kids are taught to do this. Books are written to support the developing reader with illustrations that match the words on purpose. And then as kids get a little bit more proficient with their reading, the illustrations do not match as directly. That's done on purpose as well. So let them use the pictures and use it as a strategy so that they know that it's okay. So we're going to demonstrate, look at the pictures.
Yep. So here's another book, Grandma's Cat. And we're reading along. So I'll show you the illustration first.
you want to just start from the beginning?
Yes, we could start from the beginning. How
it's
about
quick.
That?
So I'm listening in and I'm waiting till she gets stuck.
And they take a big breath
before they get going. This is a story about Grandma and her cat. So I'm pointing to the illustrations right from the beginning.
Grandma's cat is round and fat.
What's my sweet little fuzzball then? So there's just a little talking bubble that Grandma's saying.
He hides, I seek. He scoots, I peek.
So look at the picture. How do you think the cat got up in that tree?
Climbed.
See if it works.
He climbs a tree.
So we brought her back to the word. So she got stuck on climbs. There's a picture, There's a picture of a tree with a cat at the top of the tree. We know that climb is a very difficult word, you know, because of the blend and the B on the end. It's not going to be familiar. So we're almost anticipating words that she's going to get stuck on, but I didn't give her the word. I gave her a prompt. I brought her to the picture. She guessed first and then went back. I had her go back to see if it would work, back to the text. So I had her reread it again, and she could successfully read the sentence that she just got stuck on.
Mm-hmm. How do you feel about that one?
Good.
Look, captain to her knee. She was climbing.
Scrape. I scrape my knee.
Great reading, Laura.
He's up the stair. I chase him there.
So you get the idea. So absolutely use the pictures. Wait till they get stuck. And then if it works, if it's an appropriate strategy, absolutely tie them to the picture and then bring them back to the text and have them reread. It's really useful to reread the whole sentence. So just bring them back to the beginning of the sentence and say, you want to try that one again? And then they're going to get it, they're going to feel great, and they're going to want to keep reading with you.
Mm-hmm. So now something of parents of children that you know, they always typically will bring you the same book to read again and again and again. So one of the strategies is to read it again. It's okay that they have memorized the book. They're building confidence. So here's an example, which don't get rid of those really easy reader board books. Children can read them. They can read them to your fish, to your dog, to their stuffed animals. They're learning how to hold a book, print concepts. Here's the cover. There's the back. I turn the page in a certain progression. And the predictability, it builds comfort. Does a horse sleep? Here's a great beginning picture book. What is that? It's a horse. What is that? It's a hive. And this is a book that you turn various aspects of, and the picture clues are great for those very beginning readers. But again, you're turning this left to right. It's silly. Children love silly stories, and those are the ones that they often want to read again and again, and the silliness has worn off on you. So this is, but when they're rereading books, they're building fluency with their confidence. Children, when they're beginning to read, I purposely read a little slow and choppy. I didn't have much fluency. When I gained some confidence, when I had help with a word, when I reread it, the flow was a little better. It was like when you're speaking. Children are able to read these with some fluency. Does a bird sleep in a stable? And you can work on their voice. Now you've got expression. So those books, when they're rereading, you can then focus on other elements, changing your voice for the question mark. You can add, just that silliness to your voice so that it's not that robot reading word by word. So as much as you say, we've already read that, if they're having a choice, they could pick one of their favorites to read again, and then you can help pick another to model vocabulary, work on some of the other strategies. But this just, again, building that confidence as a reader is significant. It goes so far to know when you can really do something and do it well. So don't get rid of those early reader books.
So they can also read that, that reread to a sibling. Doesn't have to necessarily be to you. I heard Lauren say to the pets. To the fluency is something that we intentionally teach in school, and it really does build a lot of
expression and things like that, so students can really be bogged down on word-by-word reading because they think that's what good readers do. So this is all about, and we're going to give you prompts week three about things to say to your child to encourage them that makes them feel like a good reader, but that's one of them. You know what I just noticed you do? I just noticed you went back when you got stuck on that word. That's what good readers do. When they hear you say those words, it's so incredibly empowering that, wow, you think I'm a good reader. So what we do, you know, students who struggle at school who are reading, belabored reading, because they're being so careful not to make a mistake, and it's every word like this, it's going to impact on comprehension. So we work on fluency, and that's where the reread that Lauren's talking about is so important. So just a little personal story. My daughter, do you have any Robert Munch books here?
Oh, I love Robert Munch.
So my daughter, so she grew up in Canada. Robert Munch is a Canadian author, and he was known, very well known, for telling stories, just telling stories out loud, and then he would write them down. But his stories were very humorous, and there was lots of expression, and when you think about like a four-year-old reading it, there's no way they could read it. It's just too difficult to read. But I had read this story to her so many times. It was called The Boy in the Drawer, and the boy did naughty things, the child did naughty things and blamed the boy in the drawer for doing those naughty things, right? So I'd read it and read it and read it and read it, and she had it down verbatim. I'm sure you have examples of this in your home. And she would say, and she had the inflection down on every single page, and it was just hilarious to listen to her read it. But what I noticed her starting to do, without me prompting, was she started to track. So she knew when to turn the page. She knew it that well. You know when you're trying to get through a book quickly and you skip and they go, what? Yeah, so they know. So she started to track the print as she was reading. And that's something we'll talk to you about when we talk about how you can use poetry, because even though they've memorized it and you think they're not really reading, they're doing some pretty important pre-reading things, pre-reading skills. So really encourage that as well. And eventually, what they're saying and what they're pointing to will be the same thing. So we'll give you more on that when we do the poetry. So this is the one that somebody said guessing can be very useful when there's context. We want kids to use context. We want them to make a guess based on what would make sense, does it look right? So if it's a great big long word and they're going to say cat, no, it doesn't look right. So now I know something about what it should look like. And does it make sense in the context of the rest of the sentence? And so go for it. Make a good guess. It's a really good thing to do. So we're going to demonstrate that. Mr. Grumpy Motor Car. I'm just going to go to our post-its here. He drove out the gate and down the... So,
street.
I noticed that you stopped there. Why did you stop?
I said street, but...
So the word is lane, okay? So she's looking at lane. It's an unfamiliar word. She stopped because it didn't match what she expected to see there, but I'm asking her, right? So now she's processing, why did you stop? And you said because...
I know it's not street.
Right, because what would you expect street to start with? Right. So we're going to use context here. We want another word that means the same thing as street. And it rhymes with rain.
Lane?
Try it.
In the brain, to look at the letters, to look at the sound, to look at the picture. So much is going on that you need to give children some wait time for those connections to occur. It can feel, it's a few seconds, 5 seconds. What do you recommend, Nina, when you're working with children or parents for your wait time?
Just a few seconds.
Just a few, 3 to 5, I think is, a good gauge to go on. It will feel like an eternity, but yet I had an opportunity to look. I said street, it wasn't lane, but I was doing some problem solving and I wasn't quite there for road. So I had some support and then I got there. If we jump in too soon, the problem solving process doesn't happen. So I didn't make that connection because I didn't have to do it. So if you're always jumping in and supplying what the word should be, I'm not working at it and I'm not going to own that word when I encounter it in the future.
So this is the last one. We have this one too.
May we come too, said the children. May we, said the rabbit, the cat, the dog, the pig, the sheep, the chickens, the cow, and the goat.
Did something sound, was there anything that didn't sound quite right?
I think I've got all the animals. Mm-hmm.
So you said cow, I'm pointing to calf. You said cow, right there.
There it is.
There is a cow.
It begins like cow. It does. Mm-hmm.
What would you expect to see?
But there's, maybe, is that calf?
Right, so we're going to just do that. And I would have actually just let that go because it doesn't even matter, but I'm just trying to demonstrate for you. It's not about accuracy in every single word. It's more about meaning. And in this case, I'm not going to care that she said cow instead of calf.
But you waited till I was done.
I did.
Point it out,
and
not right away.
Right.
Sometimes as hard as listening to a child read.
Oh,
nope, that's this, that's that.
I also prompted her, and we're going to give you all these prompts, but I prompted her by telling her what she said. Often, the other thing is, they know when they made a mistake. If you say, did something not quite sound quite right? They'll know the exact word that didn't sound right, that they thought hoped you would notice. Script by that one. And so you bring them right back to it. And again, if you're finding and making several mistakes on every page, it's not a good book for them to be reading, especially at home with you. It should be a just right book, and that's going to be another strategy we help you with, knowing how to find the just right book. So let's stop there and talk about, give us maybe some examples or some questions that you have about things that you're wondering about with your reader at home, things that work well for you, things that maybe you're doing that you wonder, should you be doing? You have two to read to at one time, and they probably like different books.
Yes. So are there strategies? Because even if you don't have two the same age like I do, if you've got a first grader and a second grader, they may often be at the same level. So are there ways around that?
Right. So one of the things that we'll talk about in week three is a lot of strategies that you can do for multiples. That are active strategies. So read and do, and reader's theater, and rereading the same text, and using favorite songs that you can write out. So there's all sorts of ways that you can engage them, because if either they're at different levels or they have different interest levels, you might need to take a more active reading approach, so that it's still reading, but it's reading that has an activity associated with it. Reading the directions to a recipe that you've simplified for them can be really great. Or echo reading. We'll talk to you about echo reading, where we'll demonstrate, you know, they read either a page or they repeat, you read it, and then they echo it back. And so you're keeping them really engaged. So you read the line, they're holding the text. Maybe you're in the middle, I'm not sure. But you're reading the text, and then they echo on either side of you, rereading the same line. So there's all sorts of good things that you can do. The idea is engagement, though, I know. And the challenge of keeping them both interested, or more than one interested, or having a child that just really doesn't want to give you the time to spend the time with the other child. So it's really, and limited time. So it's finding ways that you can read with multiple children. Let's put that on. Could you maybe write that down? Mm-hmm. And we'll make a point of coming with some of those next week.
One of the things that I anticipate is actually going to happen is that one is going to know what the word is and jump ahead.
Yep.
And so the other one isn't going to have the opportunity to really learn through some of those techniques that you just went over.
Okay, so shadow reading and echo reading and buddy reading are all ways to support kids at different levels that are very helpful. So it's okay if they're reading together and one child knows the word and the other one doesn't. What's really important is that they're looking at the word. So tracking, even if they use their finger, is really important, because if they just hear it but they're not looking at it, you don't have the brain connection. If they're looking at it while they hear the sibling say the word, it's very helpful. even if they didn't problem solve it themselves. So it's going to have, I mean, again, I'm going to go back to that. You're not the teacher. You're providing reinforcement to reading activities at home, and anything you do is helpful.
And remember that enjoyment piece.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Right?
Correct.
I mean, you don't want to give your kids a quiz. You know, that's not the idea. So, you know, the whole idea is for it to be a pleasant experience between the two of you. It's a time when, you know, you're together, and, you know, you don't want to stop too many times and interrupt the story too many times, because the idea is to have a good time with it, you know?
Yep.
Well, so I guess to follow on to that, where we're really struggling right now is our daughter's very frustrated that, and so she'll, initiated by her, and we read every night, but she wants to read to us. She'll read four or five words, and then she's stuck. But then she'll kind of knock me, like, okay, tell me the word, but she won't even try it. And I'll say, oh, what do you think? Why don't we try? And it instantly dissolves into, you know, a fit of frustration. So, you know, should we just step in and keep going, or?
So try some of these new strategies with her that you're kind of directing a little bit. There's a strategy called nudge that we're going to talk to you about next week, and it's how you use it, because you want to nudge it back, but you do it in a very supportive way. So she's already nudging you to take on the word so that she doesn't have to, she wants to, the fluency to get going. When you see, as you read ahead, a line that you know she's going to be successful at, you just gently nudge it right back to her, and she can pick it up. So that's actually a fluency strategy and a comprehension strategy, because the child doesn't want to have to stop to figure out the word, but your children are already doing it because one's just fitting it in, and away they both go. You don't want to stop the reading from the child that knows the word. They're going to get really frustrated, right? So again, you just want to keep the momentum going and expose them. So I would try some of the more supportive strategies that we've talked about tonight with her, so she's not as on, right, worried that she's going to make a mistake, because it just sounds like she's trying so hard, and then she gets frustrated if she gets to a tricky word. And so although we said the two strategies are leave out the word or ask somebody to fit it in this case, when you use nudge, you might pick it up for a few words or a couple of sentences until she loses the frustration, and then you just can gently nudge control back to her.
So when she nudges you, you begin the reading and carry on, and then when you nudge her, she then picks up the reading.
But you nudge her back when you know some simple words coming up that you know she can sail through on. We're not trying to trick them. What other challenges do you face? We've had some great ones. You know, what do we do about the other child? And my child is frustrated. Erin, did you have one? Oh, you were just moving back there.
Are we not sounding out words?
So sound it out. We purposely left till next week.
All right.
I will challenge you all to go home and not use sound it out this week.
That's a higher level strategy.
It is. It is. And we are going to talk about it next week and talk about how to use it appropriately, when to use it. There are times when it should absolutely be used, but the challenge will be to go home and try some of these and not go to that go-to place of sound it out. What it does is it puts too much onus on decoding when the focus should be on meaning. So we need to use decoding, but so often decoding doesn't work. So often.
Think that word climb, that wouldn't have helped me.
And the words we see in children's books, like, think about the word laugh. Really? Who thought of that word? But what could you use to figure out laugh? Which one of the strategies that we talked about tonight would work well for laugh? Yeah. So just have them look at the picture and prompt them and say, what are they doing? Look at their faces, and then bring them back to the word. And then you can talk about the fact that, does that look anything like what you would expect laugh to look like? You can help me, Nina, with this. So when you're doing words their way, and there's four categories of word work, so there's the words that they can decode, but then the oddballs.
The oddballs.
They call them oddballs, the kids do. So this little girl was explaining to me over at center school one day about oddball words. And she said, so
asked me, just asked me how to spell one. So I said, how do you spell one? And she said, she wrote down W-U-N. And so she said, because that's what it sounds like. But she said, but I know that's not really how you spell it. And then she showed me how she spelled it, O-N-E. And she said, and that's why it's an oddball. And I'm like, wow. This is what she, kindergarten?
First grade. That was
she first
grade.
Grader? Yeah. So that's, you know, I think that the answer about why we're not using sound it out is that so often it's just confusing and not the best strategy. And then it really reinforces for kids that that's what reading's about. Reading is about decoding, and it just is about so much more than that.
I have a frustration that I should probably just be patient and it'll work itself out, but you might be able to tell me more about it. My daughter will like read the same word 5 times in a story, and then she'll get to it the 6th time and be completely lost.
Okay.
I don't get it. Like, I don't get how that works.
Yeah. So to Lauren's point, her head just went somewhere else. So she's either seen something in a picture that's confusing her and she's processing that, or she has, depending on where it is in the sentence, can make a difference. Mm-hmm. So all of a sudden it comes at the beginning of the sentence and has a capital and it looks really different. That could be what it is. The best strategy is to just take her back to that very word. You know, you read this word right here. Mm-hmm. Take her back, show it to her, mm-hmm. then bring her back to the page where she miscued and have her try it again. But that's what's happening there.
I think you had a question.
You've mentioned a couple of times now that it's not so much about the words, it's about the meaning. So can you speak to that a little bit? Is that kind of where the curriculum is going to be going?
So the reason we read,
the kids are going to go?
The whole reason for reading is that there's a message, or there's a lesson, or there's something we're looking to learn. So the purpose of reading is to understand the message that's in the print. And if we teach kids early on that reading is about figuring out how to decode words, then we're not teaching them the message that there's a story here, or there's a message, or there's a lesson, or there's something you're going to learn from reading these words, but more just that good readers are never make a mistake. We don't want them to think that, right? Or good readers, the other one that happens as soon as we start to assess students' fluency, is they think that good readers read really, really fast. And the faster I can read, the better reader I am. And so we actually have to slow kids down who are reading. They're disfluent because they're reading so quickly that it's affecting comprehension, because they think good readers are the ones that read really quickly. So the message we're giving is reading is all about understanding meaning, uncovering meaning. And we get there in various ways, but that's why we want to use context. We want to use cues that are around us. And we will use decoding, absolutely. We're not anti-phonics.
Right.
There's a place for that. But it needs to be used strategically. So we'll give you some examples.
And we do teach phonics. We do teach word work,
yep.
which works with spelling, carries over to writing. We'll read decodable text, meaning they're books with purposely, if you're working on the at family, there'll be a lot of at words. So we were using tonight books that you would read for enjoyment for your family. You're not the teachers that will teach them the phonics and the decoding. That's what we'll do. So when you're reading for enjoyment, practice reading at home, what strategies could you employ that will contribute to the meaning as well as help when they have some stumbles along the way?
And the word about the question about the she can read the word and then all of a sudden she can't, I wanted to make a little plug for proper nouns. So basically they don't matter in the context of meaning. And so the example that we use is names. So sometimes you'll be reading a book and there's just a very odd name that is unusual. Your child doesn't recognize it. It's not, you know, something that's familiar to them. But based on the beginning of the letter, the first two letters in the word, they might consistently say the wrong name. Just leave that alone. Just leave it alone. Let it be whatever it is. Because let it be Gretchen for Gertrude. We don't care. It's still, we know it's a character that starts with a G and it's a little girl. So it's not affecting meaning, and it's a repetitive word that you see over and over again in the story. We say the same thing when we're testing their reading with some of our assessments. It counts as an error only the first time. And after that, and we reprompt the child and say, actually, that was Gretchen, and then they go back to Gertrude again, we're good. But it's only one mistake. It's not 15. So that's kind of a similar, it's kind of the opposite, but really thinking about strategically prompting your child on words that make a difference to the meaning. That's why I said I wouldn't have stopped her on cow for calf.
And when the word that you mentioned, often those are the sight words, and it's difficult to attach meaning to them. Mm-hmm. So they read was or when here, but they're not remembering. It's hard to just attach and have a connection to those words. So just going back, here's the word, remember we read that, it's was.
So how many of you have concerns about your child's reading development? Okay. And how many of you are here just because you want to get better at helping your kids? Okay. So if you have, concerns and you want us to address them, or you want to email either of us with specific questions about your child's reading development, please do that. We're very happy.
And sometimes it's a check-in because you're not sure if things are on track not on track.
Yeah.
You just don't know where should my child be? Is this okay?
Yeah.
Think about when children were walking and somebody was walking at 6 months, somebody else was 13 months, and you're not sure where you fit in that.
And you don't necessarily want to do it in this venue either. Did you have a question?
Yeah, I was just going to ask, aside from, making reading enjoyable and doing a lot of the things that you talked about tonight, are there any other motivational strategies? I mean, I have a boy who I feel like is right on the edge, but he doesn't want to push himself.
Right.
I'm not really concerned. Like, he'll get there.
Yeah.
But he's getting to the point where I'd like to kind of nudge him a little bit more.
So what does he love? What's he interested in?
He loves...
And I don't mean that.
Science, and plants. And, yeah, nature.
Right. I would say it's so one of the resources that we're going to give you, and I'll get it off to people. You had a sign-in list, right?
Yeah.
Okay. There's some great resources for parents with book lists. So you can look up, my child has an interest in plants or whatever it might be. And gives you book titles. I know you can come to the library here, same thing. It doesn't have to be a book that is at his reading level. But if you get him interested in just like Lauren was saying, you're the model. So you're reading about plants with enthusiasm and excitement. And he's excited to listen because this is something that interests him.
Right.
There will be... So don't worry if he doesn't want to read with you. Does he like singing or music or... poetry. I mean, using children's favorite songs is another really great way, where there's a song that, either he just knows or he hears it, and then you write it out with large font and have him illustrate it, and then he can read it. And it could be really tricky vocabulary when you think about the song, but he already knows the word because he's memorized it, and now he can be reading along.
I mean, we spend a lot of time in the library. He loves reading. He loves being read, too.
Good.
So, that's
you're good.
All there,
just start right there. You don't want him to feel pressured that,
Yes. I apologize, I came late, so I know you're going to tell me you already talked to me.
No, we won't. We won't say that.
But you just mentioned sight words. Now, I'm starting, I've been working with my third daughter. With my first two, we always started with sight words and then, beginner reader books and kind of took it from there, and it's worked well for me. But I'm getting the feeling, and coupled with that, I read them a story.
Great.
But like what I'll do, and I'm a bit methodical, is we'll start with a few sight words for our next group. We'll try to read a book together, then I'll read them a story that they can just kind of listen to. Are you suggesting that maybe the sight words is not fun enough? Like that's not, I guess...
Maybe it's not the main focus of your reading.
Yeah.
Read for enjoyment. Read, certainly you can, after you read a story, look, I know I saw the word the on this page. Can you find it? But if your child's learning the sight words, they're having some difficulty, it will make the story so choppy. It's not going to be enjoyable. And then over time, you'll see they really don't want to read with you because it's just so much work and it's challenging for them. So you can certainly reinforce sight words, but maybe that's not the main focus when you're reading together. They can read.
No, I apologize. I mean the whole thing about showing them the little
flashcards.
Just let me kind of play a game with it.
Mm-hmm.
I'm sounding it out though.
So that's
and
different.
And we use it in a sentence, and then we kind of put them aside, and then we read them.
Are they? Do they like it? Are they having fun while they're doing it? Then great, do it. If they like it, do it. You're not doing any harm.
Doing something that's
no. No, you're not.
You're helping craft. Develop automaticity with those
you
words
are.
Because those are the words that you often cannot sound out. So when you are reading and you encounter them, the doesn't sound.
Right.
I mean, so many of them, they just don't sound. You need to know it. So you're helping develop that.
Yep. I think that the question about whether they, if they become resistant to it, then you just stop doing it. Because actually, when they see that sight word, whatever it is, 20 times in connected text, it will be a known word.
Right.
So, right? So if they see it as a drill, versus if they see it in a sentence in connected text, the more they're reading in a text, that we believe that's better, but you're not doing any harm by removing it from the text either. Did I hear you say that they're sounding it out? So you can't...
There's certain sight words that, you know...
Okay.
That are... I almost wonder if they're put in there just to give them some confidence.
Yeah. So they should be automatic though, right? It should be either it's at or it's you move on. We don't want to drag it out at, right? It has to be automatic if it's sight. Okay. You must think I hate phonics. I really don't. I just know that there's a place for it and we don't want to overly stress that part of it. Because it gives the wrong message, but now I'm repeating myself. So,
well, we'll talk about sounded out next week.
Talking about like meaning books that they have a meaning, there's a story, and when I read to my girls at night, they pick these chapter books from the library that, you know, I'm following along and I don't even know the meaning of the story, but they're excited about it. But I, I don't know if I should be steering away from those kind of books.
Are they enjoying the books?
They're enjoying it, but...
When you talk about it, do they understand it? Are they comprehending it?
Yes.
Okay.
But there's like a lot going on and it doesn't really all come together at the end a lot.
Yeah. I would talk to your librarian just in terms of making choices that, you know, specific choices. But if it doesn't come together and so there's not a clear message, then I would think that...
Right. It's my kindergartner who's picking out the book.
Oh,
and
if it's
like,
at school, they just love to pick
the
books from the shelves.
And I feel like she's excited because it is a chapter book series.
Yeah.
And, you know, I even think like my first grader is like, oh, no, not another one of these books again. Because they really just don't go anywhere.
Right. So, so there's two things going on there. One is that peer pressure, right? So they go to the library, and their teacher's not with them at the library, and they might be choosing books that other kids who are perceived as the good readers in the class are choosing, and so they want to choose that book because that makes them feel good. The other thing is that sometimes they choose really difficult books because they don't want to be able to read it. So if I choose this one, there's no way she's going to make me read it because I can't. So now I'm off the hook. So I think, you know, maybe having something, a very supportive strategy in a book that you know that, you know, no pressure, and then letting her enjoy listening to a chapter book that does have some meaning gives her a little bit of both.
So I would suggest balancing it out. So while she's choosing that book, maybe another read aloud if you have a chapter book that you're reading a little bit of each night, or a picture book that's your choice.
Mm-hmm.
And then you can sort of help broaden the horizon in terms of choices. And sometimes the books, it's the character and it's the theme that they just get caught up
in.
Now, our librarian here, Denise Coffrin, put together a nice pamphlet for you that has a list of books, some of her favorites. Do you want to speak to them, Denise?
Not an exhaustive list, just some that are my favorites. I pulled a few of them up. You can take a look at. There's plenty more, and if I went on with all my favorites, this would be a book. So I'm happy to help anybody find anything in a particular subject or reading, you know, if your child's reading on something, you know, something similar to it, or if you're concerned about, you know, I'm a specialist, but if you can tell me something that they've read that they're comfortable with, I can usually suggest something that's, equivalent.
This is just a great selection. I'm just glancing at it, just some wonderful books. And we had given Denise, there's also a list that we have that supports the strategies that we're talking about each week, and Denise kindly offered to pull some of those books that she might have in her collection. So
the first week I didn't have that many.
Well, there weren't. It was just interesting. Yeah.
And some of it is I looked some of them up and they were printed in the 90s or something. So they're not necessarily
okay.
And obviously, as you all know, we have a space problem here. And I think the budget has gotten better in the last few years because I've been able to buy pretty much anything that I can fit into the room. And I think that's why there are some books I can get like for next week from I'll put out for interlibrary loan and get them in. But
thank you.
That's the best thing with a small library with interlibrary loan. If there's something that you want, we can usually get it.
And so that was the other intention of tonight, was because you're already here, if there are books that you want to check out. I don't know, Denise.
Anything that's here, I can check out for you. I've got the one computer down here, but I'd ask if you could do it before 8:30.
Okay, that's what we had thought. We wanted to have time for you to do that and take out books and just talk amongst yourselves, come and chat with Lauren and I, and again,
Enjoy refreshments.
Thanks.
Which
to
is
a
treat.
But yeah, email us, and I hope to see you next week. If you can't make it, no worries. Oh, we'll leave the extras, Denise, in case there are people who want to come.
Put these on file because we're redoing the children's page for the website, and hopefully it will be up in the next couple of days because he emailed me today. But I can put a link on them.
That's great. Do you think we should wait until we've done the whole series and then send the whole thing off to you?
That would be awesome.
We really didn't want to just put them out there without any
background. But if you have extras of these, I'd be happy to put them
out. And then each week, as I had said, I don't know if you were here, we'll choose a different color, and then that way people can come and get the strategies, and you'll be able to listen in if you're not able to be here in person. So thanks again.
Okay. Thank you.